Maple syrup's been around since indigenous people. So it's been around hundreds and maybe thousands of years. Maple syrup, you know, extends from people having thousands of taps, 7,000, I know, you know, or more taps in these trees, and you'll see those later, but to just a family with a couple trees, they tap them and boil it down. They'll hang a bucket right on the tree and just collect that way, versus a system like this is more advanced and more sophisticated, and it produces more. Finding sugar maples in your woods is not too difficult. Generally, they have a smoother gray bark, and it's kind of modeled on the surface, some little kind of warty in some cases. The small ones look different than the big ones, of course. They change as they age. But as the trees get bigger, they'll still retain their smooth kind of gray bark, but they'll have these long kind of plates that peel up on one side generally, and those are fairly thick plates. We'll see some out here. The most productive ones are the sugar maples, but red maple as well. It has a good sugar content, good sap flow. All the maples can be tapped. Even box elder, which is a type of a maple, not too many people know that, but box elder can be tapped. You just need more sap to boil down to 1 gallon. It takes more gallons of sap to make a gallon of maple syrup. This is a modern sugar camp. You know, this is an educational facility, but also they'll also be out here boiling sap, and so this is kind of what it looks like. So we're very fortunate. It's a great facility for students to come out here and learn how to tap trees and learn about kind of the biology and the management of a sugar bush. There's all sorts of techniques and technology associated with a sugar bush like this one. You can see all the pipes, all the tubes, you know, and there's cool equipment that you use to splice and put them together, put them into the trees, make connections, and so forth. But generally, they keep the main lines up all year. And then just recently, within the past 3 weeks, the students have been out here. You know, the students are part of a course that Dr. Jamie Schuler teaches. So we're very lucky here at West Virginia University to have this facility, this sugar bush and the sugar shack.
This sugar bush operation started in 2014 with a grant from the West Virginia Department of Agriculture, especially crop block grant. And that's funneled through from some federal funding, gave us the money to buy basically the equipment that you see out there. And the university put in some money for the buildings. The magical thing about making syrup, it's really not that difficult. All you do is boil a whole bunch of water. You know, at 2%, which a lot of people use as kind of that rough estimate, we have to have about 43 gallons of sap to make 1 gallon of maple syrup. You know, our trees aren't quite as good here, or at least don't have quite the sugar content. And so we're probably boiling 53 gallons of water to get that 1 gallon of maple syrup. Effectively, what we're doing and what all operations do is just try to find efficient ways to remove that water. One of the reasons that we're out here is that this particular property has a fairly decent amount of sugar maple. It's our state tree. It's obviously one that's important for us as well. But just from a sheer number standpoint, we seem to have a lot more reds. But it's nice that this particular property has sugar maple. It tends to have a higher sugar content, which is why people prefer it. What we're trying to do is provide a conduit to get the sap from the tree down to our sugar house. Okay, and that's basically what we're looking at here, is just kind of an elaborate plumbing system. This little spout here, this spile, there's a hole that's drilled into the tree, only about 2 inches deep. And we insert this spout into the tree, and that's just a little elbow, basically. And that provides an opportunity for that sap to drip out into the spout, down this tube, into this long line that goes up and down the hill. And it just flows via gravity down the slope there, and we collect it into that tank. And so there's a pump way up on the farm, and we run about 1,000 feet of tubing that provides vacuum to this machine, which is called a releaser. And basically what that does is it allows vacuum to come into this machine, go up those lines. So we talk about those lines that come down the hill. This machine distributes that vacuum to those lines, and the sap runs down the hill through these lines here into this releaser. And what this basically does is it allows the vacuum and the sap to coexist. And so when the sap comes in here, it drains into this tank. There's a float in here. That float raises, and when it gets to a certain point, it dumps. And what that does is it temporarily cuts that vacuum off. Otherwise, it wouldn't be able to dump that sap out of the tank. And so the sap dumps, we collect it into this big tank here. Once we get a sufficient amount, we'll run it through that reverse osmosis machine that we talked about. When we run it through the reverse osmosis, we'll then pump it into this upper tank. And this upper tank is what's connected to our evaporator. And so through this tubing system here, it goes into the other building, and that's where we'll start the boiling process. So most of the boiling takes place in this back pan, which is about 4 feet long, and ours is 2 feet wide. And then it comes into the front pan, which is what we call the syrup pan. And this is where we talked about that flavor development in maple syrup, and that's where a lot of it happens here. And so these two are connected, these two pans are connected via this pipe. And so when the sap is ready, it comes through this pipe and into this front box. And what you'll see is that it has a series of channels in there. And what will happen is, as that syrup changes density, it keeps getting moved forward and forward and forward. And so as that water or that sap in there evaporates, it concentrates that syrup. And so as it evaporates, we get more water taking its place, coming in behind. And so each one of those channels that you see in this pan is closer and closer to syrup, okay, as it evaporates out. Basically, the last part of this process is drawing off when it becomes syrup. And so syrup is legally syrup when it's 7.1 degrees above the boiling point of water. And so that changes depending on elevation. So water boils at 212 at sea level, and it probably boils about 210 here just because of our elevation. And so you add 7 degrees to that, and so it's about 217 or so, which would be when we would draw off. And so when we have our thermometer here, and so when we see that it's 217 or close to it, that's when we basically will open the valve and draw off the syrup from that pan. And once it's syrup, what we typically will do, what producers will do, is then they'll run that through some sort of a filtration system just to clear out some of the sediment, a lot of the calcium, magnesium, some of those minerals that precipitate out during that boiling process. We just remove that because people don't want to taste that in their pancakes. So we just run that through a simple filter, and then it goes into a bottle and on a shelf somewhere.